Together at the invitation of Carly and Bradley to celebrate their union and Christian love in their hearts and in their lives. This is possible through the love that God has given us through Jesus Christ. If you would, please all everyone stand. Please bow your heads. Father, Thank you for this day. Thank you for this wonderful weather we've had. And thank you for this love. Bless this service. Bless all that are here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus said, I am come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. This abundant life for many people seems to be an impossible dream, that God wants all of us to have this abundant life. And he's proved his love for us by his son, that through him we may have the full life that he's offering. Another way that God provides for this full life is creating those who will love us. Brad has found this love in Carly, as their hearts and spirits are drawn together before today by the Lord of all creation. Two lives are not united by ceremony, but only in the power love and grace of God. Sorry. Brad and Carly are here to publicly declare that because of the love of Jesus Christ, they too can truly love one another, as God has demonstrated his love in Jesus our Lord. Brad and Carly will demonstrate this God-given love by giving themselves one to another. I want to start off today a little differently, and this would be normal for me. I want to share a few things that I think will be beneficial to not only Carly and Brad, but to everybody, to newlyweds as well as long-timers. There's some things that we can all take away today and that would help us all in our relationships. And the first thing is that we have to understand you are different. Opposites do tend to attract, and you're not only different physically, but there are differences in your background, your outlook on life, your approach to certain situations. They're not intended to be problems for your marriage, but God designed these differences for a reason. The more a couple learns to celebrate the differences, the stronger the marriage will become. The Bible tells us also that we're to leave and cleave. And we need to decide, every couple should decide in advance that no one, friend, relative, or anyone can become a wedge between the two. Every couple has lots of other relationships, including perhaps even children someday, but none of them should be allowed to interfere with the oneness God intends to create in marriage. This is always my favorite. We should always expect surprises. Like me doing this. Life won't always be as harmonious as it is today. There'll be hard days, whether self-induced or life-induced. Life will bring changes, and those times have the ability to catch even the best marriages off guard if not prepared. We can never be too fully prepared for what might come, but we can prepare ourselves for that when things come, whatever it is, and no matter how hard it is, that we can handle it. And we need to use those times as couples to improve and strengthen our marriage rather than let them be pulled apart. We should also make a commitment to the marriage no matter what. Couples usually assume they're doing this by standing at the altar, but statistics would tell us otherwise. Many times these days, a person is saying, I'm committed until it becomes difficult, until the love we have today fades. That's not the biblical picture of marriage that God designed. Marriage is more than simply just a feeling of love. It's a commitment to love. For better or worse, from this day forward, verbalizing and agreeing that on the front end and continuing to remind yourself of that through the difficult days will help your marriage last. One that I've learned to use throughout my life is that we should always model our relationship after the right couple. Find somebody whose marriage you admire. Follow them closely. Most likely they have some stories to share. Things may not have always been as wonderful throughout their marriage as they are today, but no doubt they've learned some ways to strengthen their marriage. I challenge you to learn all you can from the couple you want to be like. You should evaluate often. You know, we should always ask, is our marriage growing stronger? Are there things that we need to address? Don't assume your spouse feels as you do. And I have learned this is especially true for men who don't often know there's a problem until it's a big problem. Can I get an amen? establish the understanding early in the relationship that you have the right to periodically check the state of your marriage. You know it's in good shape. And finally, but never least, you got to put Christ first. You know? This is the one that most couples expect a pastor to say. But it's not the preacher answering. It's the best way to ensure a lasting marriage. The Bible tells us a cord of three strands is not easily broken. A couple's individual and collective relationship with Christ will ensure that they can endure the hardest days of marriage. When the relationship with Christ suffers, the marriage will often suffer. Satan will look for any opportunity he can to destroy the marriage. Pour your heart and life into Christ and let him strengthen and sustain your marriage. Brad and Carly, no other human ties are more tender, no other vows are more sacred than these you're about to assume. You're entering into that holy state, which is the deepest mystery of experience, and which is the very sacrament of divine love. Brad, will you have Carly to be your wedded wife, to live together after God's ordinance? In the holy state of matrimony, will you love her, comfort her, honor her, keep her in sickness and in health, forsaking all others, keeping yourself only for her as long as you both shall live? Carly, will you have Brad to be your wedded husband, to live after God's ordinance in the holy state of matrimony? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only for him as long as you both shall live. Brad, what token do you give as a pleasure, as a pledge of the sincerity of your vows? Carly, what token do you give as a pledge of the sincerity of your vow? A ring is a fitting symbol to represent the covenant you're making today. Not only are these made out of the finest metals, reminding you of the purity of the relationship, but they are also a circle, a line unending, reminding you of your love, devotion, and commitment to one another are to be unending. All right, Brad, would you repeat after me? I, Brad, take you, Carly, to be my wife, before God who brought us together, to love and cherish you, even as Christ loved the church, and gave himself for it, to lead you, to share all of life's experiences with you, that through his grace we might grow together into the likeness of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Carly, would you repeat after me? I, Carly, take you, brother, to be my wedded husband, before God who has brought us together, to love and cherish you, to submit myself to you in all things, and to follow you through all of life's experiences, as you follow God, that through his grace, we might grow together into the likeness of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Let us pray. Father in heaven, is such a special time when two people are joining together as one and become one flesh. And Lord, we are so thankful for the two lives represented here, and we see how your divine hand has worked in the process in bringing them to this point. And what a great testimony it is of their lives that they shared with each other and are the perfect fit. We know that testifies to your grace and goodness and sovereignty. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for the friends and family that have come to share in this wonderful celebration of life, Lord. We ask you to bless the marriage as it moves forward. We ask you to continue to offer your hand of comfort to them in times of need. We ask you to let them know that you're there to lean upon when times do get difficult. We know that life's not always easy, but that you are always there. We ask you to continue to bless their household, their decisions, and let everything they do always be in accordance with your will. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the time that we get to spend together in this wonderful ceremony. We thank you for Brad. We thank you for Carla. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. And as much as you have pledged to each other, your lifelong commitment, love, and devotion, by the authority committed to me as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ and according to the laws of the state of Texas, I now declare you husband and wife in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Brad, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to be the first to introduce you to Mr. and Mrs. Bradley Ashmore. Thank everybody for coming. I have a note page here. Bear with me. I hear you.
There you are, Daddy.
The bride and groom, as usual, are going to have a few pictures made here. We ask everybody that can, feel free to take your chair as you move towards the seating area. Those that can't, we've got some young men that are going to be carrying them behind you. We have food, and I think we have a few desserts. Tons. In the barn, you're welcome to go in either direction. There's food, drinks, and there'll be a wonderful band and a wonderful dance floor that everybody can show out on. And the couple will be over shortly. Thank you all for coming.